The International Commission on Illumination has standardized three specific wavelengths as three primary colors. Namely, the blue color has been standardized to a wavelength of 435.8 nanometer. The green color has been standardized to a wavelength of 546.1 nanometer. And the red color has been standardized to a wavelength of 700 nanometer. But it is actually not required, or it is not of such importance to standardize these or any other wavelengths to say them as primary colors, because it will be totally incorrect if we say that these three colors, or as they are being called as primary colors, it is incorrect. Still incorrect to say that these three colors, when mixed in different intensity proportions, can produce all visible colors. So this statement is not correct. We cannot produce the entire range of visible colors by varying the intensity proportions of these three primary colors. If you need to generate each and every color which is ever possible in this visible range of colors, you need to vary the wavelength also. Varying the intensity proportions of the primary colors will not work out. You need to use multiple wavelengths in different intensity proportions to get to a new secondary color. So if you need to cover up the all entire range of visible colors along with the intensity proportions getting mixed up, you need also to vary the wavelengths. So let us discuss some more about the primary colors and secondary colors. Primary colors for light are different than primary colors for pigments. Here you see two diagrams. In this figure, there are two diagrams. One diagram is to show the primary and secondary color, how they work out for when we are talking about primary and secondary colors in the case of light. And here we have another diagram to let you understand the interplay of primary and secondary colors for the pigments. So basically, we are going to discuss the interplay of primary and secondary colors in the case of light and the interplay of primary and secondary colors for the case of pigments. So in the case of light, we have three primary colors: the green, the red, and the blue. These are the primary colors. When three of the primary colors, red, green, and blue, combine, they produce white. So this is a region where red, green, and blue, three of them combine. Okay, and they produce white color. Now, this is the case we are discussing for the light. Okay. Again, if you see in the same diagram, when any primary color, let's say red is a primary color, when it combines with the opposite secondary. So what are the secondary colors? Yellow, cyan, and magenta are the secondary colors of light. So what I was trying to exemplify is, look at this primary color, which is red, and its opposite secondary color is cyan. Okay? So when a primary color mixes with the opposite secondary color, it again produces white. Okay, you see here, when red combines with cyan, it produces white. Okay, so this region, the region which is looking white, in the absence of red would have been cyan only. This region, in the absence of red, would have been cyan only. But because we have red contribution and cyan contribution, we are getting white. So what you can conclude here is, a primary when combined with the opposite secondary produces white color. Okay, but in what other way you can produce white? Either you can produce a white color by combining three of the primaries, or you can get the white by combining the primary with the opposite secondary. So we can take another example. We have a secondary magneta, secondary color of light, that is magneta. When it combines with the primary green, it will give you white color. So again, the same thing, primary combining with the opposite secondary gives you a white color. Now let us come to the interplay of primary and secondary in the case of pigments. This is about mixture of pigments. The earlier was the case of mixture of light. Okay, and here for the case of pigments, you'll see that the yellow, magenta and cyan are the primary colors of pigments. Okay, just the opposite of what was the case in the case of light. Okay, here the yellow, magenta and cyan are the primary colors of pigment. Okay, so when three of the primaries of pigments combine, they produce black. Okay, yellow, magenta and cyan, they combine to give you black. Okay, so in a correspondence with what we have discussed here also you will see that when a primary combines with the opposite secondary, it produces black. When a primary color of pigments combine with the opposite secondary color of pigment, it produces black. Magenta and green produces black. Then again you will see red and cyan. Cyan is a primary, red is the secondary. And together they produce black. Okay, so likewise. Okay, there are a couple of interesting things to observe here. Let us go some more deeper in this diagram. See here, a pigment can be think of it as a colorant, a substance. Okay, so it looks yellow in the presence of white light. That means when you are incidenting a white light onto a colorant or a pigment, it looks yellow because the blue is getting absorbed. When blue is getting absorbed, for the white light incident on the pigment, the blue getting absorbed. So what is reflected back is red and green. Okay, a pigment looks yellow because blue is getting absorbed, and so red and green only gets reflected. So when red and green are getting reflected, you know already that red and green gives you yellow color. So the pigment is looking yellow. Okay, now for a pigment which looks magenta in color, this thing has taken place because for the white incident light, the green is getting absorbed by the pigment. So when green is getting absorbed, only red and blue are getting reflected, and you already know that red and blue produce magenta, so the pigment is looking magenta. Okay, so in this pigment the blue is getting absorbed, in this pigment the green is getting absorbed. So this is a common region. So a pigment which represents this region, for this the green and the blue both are getting absorbed. So obviously, so when from white light green and blue both are getting absorbed, white minus green minus blue will give you definitely the red color. Yes or no? Because we already know that red, green and blue produce white light. White light or white intensity is produced. Okay. So when green and blue are getting absorbed in a pigment, it will appear red in color. Okay, let us try to understand how we can characterize the color. Okay, you may say that we have once talked about characterizing the light, the color light, in terms of radiance, luminance and brightness, isn't it? So why are we discussing again about characterizing color when we have already studied something as characterizing the colored light, color light? Then why are we talking again about characterizing color? It should have the same thing to be applied here also. But thing is that in the earlier context, when we said characterizing the light, we were trying to characterize the quality of color light. Okay? In the earlier context, when we are trying to characterize the color light in terms of radiance, luminance and brightness, we were basically characterizing the quality of color light. But in here, what we are going to discuss now, we are trying to characterize the color itself. We want to have a criteria to tell one color from other. We want to distinguish one color from any other color. So that is the motive for characterizing the color here. Okay. So let us start. The color can be characterized in terms of brightness, hue, saturation. Okay, three characteristics can be used to characterize a color, which can be helpful to tell one color from other. What are the three characteristics? Brightness, hue and saturation. Let us try to understand what are these characteristics and what do they signify. Okay, so brightness is as I'm showing in the definition, it embodies the achromatic notion of intensity. So whatever role the intensity plays for an achromatic light, for a monochromatic light, the same importance the brightness has in the case of chromatic light. That means if the amount of light reaching the observer is more, the brightness will be more. It is similar to the intensity. Okay, intensity is roughly the amount of light reaching the observer. So here also the brightness, as I told you, brightness embodies the achromatic notion of intensity. So brightness will be more if the amount of light reaching to the observer will be more. Now come to hue. What is the meaning of hue? When an observer is looking onto some object. So the object is appearing in a certain color because it is reflecting light, which is a mixture of certain wavelengths of light. So whatever is the predominant wavelength in the reflected light that is reaching the retina of the observer, what is the predominant wavelength of the light reaching to the retina, that comprise the hue. So any object, let's say, which appears green to me, what does this mean? This means that the object is such that it is reflecting me a mixture of different wavelengths to my retina of my eye, in which the predominant wavelength is giving me a sensation of green light. So if anything has to give me a sensation of some other color, it must have some different predominant wavelength. Let's say some other object looks red to me. That means the mixture of light that is coming to my retina has the predominant wavelength, which is giving me that particular red sensation. Okay. So now, what is saturation characteristic of a color? So saturation is the relative purity or amount of white light mixed with a hue. To exemplify this, let us suppose some object is appearing red to me. Okay, so it is pure red. When it is pure red, then we can call it as it is a saturated form of some hue, and that is red hue. Okay, if it is appearing completely red to me, okay, so I can say that this hue of red is completely saturated. This is to signify that there is least contribution of white light on with that red color. Suppose I start mixing white light onto that, okay, red light mixed with white light. So I have a control, let's say I have a control of how much white light I can add to that particular red light. Okay, so I start with a small amount of white light at the beginning. So the more and more I am adding the white light, the resultant light, the mixture of white and red, it is getting more and more, okay, it is losing its saturation level. So we can say that the more we are adding the white light, the resultant light is getting less saturated, lesser saturated for that particular red hue. Okay, so as we move from red towards pink, we are going from most saturated to least saturated. So red is the most saturated form of red hue, and pink is the least saturated version of the hue red.